So today's speaker is Frederick Clarkson, speaking about religious freedom as a progressive value. Mr. Clarkson is a senior research analyst at the Political Research Associates, a progressive think tank in Somerville, Massachusetts. He has been writing about religion and politics for more than three decades. His work has appeared in a wide range of publications from Mother Jones, Church and State, and Ms. Magazine, to Christian Science Monitor, Salon.com, and Religion Dispatches. He has worked as an investigative editor at Planned Parenthood Federation of America, as communications director at the Institute for Democracy Studies, and co-founded the group blog, Talk to Action. He is the author, co-author, or editor of several books, including Dispatches from the Religious Left, The Future of Faith and Politics in America, and Eternal Hostility, The Struggle Between Theocracy and Democracy. He has been called on by the media for expert analysis for his entire career. He has been quoted in major newspapers, including the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the Los Angeles Times. His radio and television appearances include NPR, Democracy Now!, Al Jazeera, BBC, and CBS Evening News. Please welcome Frederick Clarkson.
Well, thank you all for coming out in the rain this morning.
Thank you for coming out.
Oh, well, very well. I didn't get too wet. even though I have some prepared thoughts, Monica said, well, why don't you just talk a little bit about yourself first? That's a dangerous thing, but you never know what one might say. But the question was, how did I get involved in this work that you just heard about? It has been a very unusual life, I have to say. Very few people do these kinds of things. And the short of it is that I found myself living and working in Washington, D.C. when Ronald Reagan came to town. And when Ronald Reagan came to town, it wasn't just Ronald Reagan. He came with the early stirrings of the conservative movement, including earlier versions of what we now call the religious right or the Christian right. And suddenly, Washington was a very different place, certainly different than anything I expected or what I had seen before they all came to town. This led to a lot of questions for me. And as a writer, I began to write. And I just never really stopped. It was big and large and constantly interesting and shocking to me. And one of the things we'll talk about a little bit later on, and that is how I think that a lot of what surprised me and continues to surprise me still has not sunk in with much of the rest of society that's living in another time, in another series of thoughts, and not really caught up with the reality that is even Donald Trump's Washington. So that said, I'm surprised to be talking about this subject today as well, because that's part of the surprise. As Monica indicated earlier, how is it that religious freedom, of all things, is under siege, under threat in our time? And one of the things I kept bumping into over the years, 30 years of writing about these things, is the idea that America was founded as a Christian nation. Now, I didn't think so, and I read a lot of stuff that people said, no, that's not so, and I wrote some of that stuff myself. But that idea is used to justify the Christian right's contemporary definition of what religious freedom is. And it's often conflated with their particular ideas of what Christianity is as well. It's the founding fathers are for it, they believe in a Christian nation, and so religious freedom is about having a Christian nation, right? But that is the thinking, and that's kind of where we are. So, but that said, it's like, well, okay, if that's not the story, what is the story? Most of the time when we hear the issues that are being discussed, it's usually not about what religious freedom is, but what it isn't, right? It's not about discrimination, it's not to justify discrimination, and things like that. But so it gets me to an old solve politics. And that is, if you don't like the story that's being told, you tell a different story. So I find that our general side is not telling the story very well. So this is my effort to try to tell a different story. So religious freedom, as we said, is the central issue of our time. It's figured in prominent decisions of the Supreme Court. It's been a major theme of the Christian right in both its evangelical and Catholic expressions as a part of their effort to implement their agenda. And in June, the Supreme Court will announce its decision in the case of Masterpiece Cake Shop versus the Colorado Civil Rights Commission, where it'll be decided whether businesses can discriminate against LGBTQ people in the course of normal business practice by invoking their religious objections to same-sex marriage. Now, no matter how the case is decided, religious freedom will continue to be an issue for the lives of everyone here today and probably well beyond. That said, religious freedom is something that just about everybody says that they're for, but we really don't agree on what it means. So I define it as the right to believe as you will and to change your mind as often as you like without the undue influence of government and religious institutions and the rich and the powerful. But there are those who are seeking to use the idea of religious freedom to undermine it. As envisioned by Thomas Jefferson and James Madison, religious freedom is an idea that seeks to prevent government from enforcing the doctrines of powerful religious factions. But that idea is being undermined, and we have our work cut out for us. But so let's make no mistake about what's going on.
Can you raise your voice?
Sure. So this weekend in Washington, D.C., just for example, you probably see on television the Conservative Political Action Conference, CPAC, and that's getting a lot of attention. It didn't used to, and it certainly merits that kind of attention. What's getting almost no attention is a big evangelical prayer rally being held at the Trump Hotel a few blocks from the White House. And it's called the Turnaround, and it's intended to defend Trump, who they believe has been chosen by God to help them advance what they call biblical decrees. And they see themselves raising up an army of special forces on his behalf. Now, these leaders include people who are not as well known as Jerry Falwell or Robert Jeffress, named Cindy Jacobs, Chuck Pierce, Dutch Sheets, that's his real name, and Lou Engel. But although they're not well known, they were pivotal to the election of Donald Trump, out here in Washington, to defend his teetering presidency and employing the unambiguous using unambiguous theocratic language and the threat of religious war. That's in their promotional materials. It's kind of, they're right out front about it. So for decades, the broad theocratic movement that we generally, those of us who write about these things, call dominionism, and the leaders I just mentioned are a part of it, have been rising in plain sight. The people who I just mentioned are very well-known figures in their world. But now they're also a close ally of the President of the United States, and they're enjoying access to power that ostensibly more moderate evangelicals could only dream of. So dominionism is very simple. It's the idea that Christians are called by God to exercise dominion over every aspect of society by taking control of political and cultural institutions. But since the people I've mentioned are not exactly household names, you may wonder, well, do they really reflect the intentions of the wider Christian right with regards to religious liberty? And so let me offer a different example. Tony Perkins, it's probably a better known name, you've probably seen him on television. He's heads the Family Research Council, which is the largest and most influential Christian right lobby group in Washington. Back in 2014, when marriage equality had not yet been decided by the court, Perkins not only questioned the authenticity of the Christianity of those who support marriage equality, but he questioned their right to religious freedom itself, because he claimed that true religious freedom only applies to orthodox religious viewpoints. Now, this brings us to a crucial point. In the face of such ideas, it's important to know and to remember and to be able to articulate that religious freedom has nothing to do with religion. Religious freedom is a right, it's not a religion, and it's not anybody's particular religion. It's also understood to be synonymous with the right of individual conscience and the freedom of mind. James Madison wrote that when the Virginia Convention of 1776 issued the Virginia Declaration of Rights, that was 3 weeks before the Declaration of Independence, the delegates removed any language about religious toleration and instead declared the freedom of conscience to be a natural and absolute right. But as clear as the founders sought to be on all this, it was and remains a confusing area, and they knew it. Thomas Jefferson wanted to be clear about these things, so he wanted to be remembered for exactly three things, which he directed be engraved on his grave marker. He wanted to be known as the author of the Declaration of Independence, father of the University of Virginia, and author of the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom. Now, why, we might ask, would Jefferson, who had been a governor, secretary of state, and a two-term president, choose this piece of state legislation that most Americans had never even heard of? I didn't know until fairly recently. So, the reason is simple, and it's actually why we're here today. Religious freedom is one of the most liberatory ideas in human history. The exact language of the key point in the Virginia Statute in archaic 18th century English says that all men shall be free to profess and by argument to maintain their opinions in matter of religion, and that the same shall in no wise diminish, enlarge, or affect their civil capacities. Now, in contemporary plain English, we might say people's religious or non-religious views shall neither advantage or disadvantage their status as citizens. Well, Jefferson and other of the founders knew that the freedom they were seeking to establish was fragile and likely to be opposed, undermined, or reinterpreted in the future. That's why late in his life, Jefferson wanted to get in the last word of his signature legislation, emphasized that the Virginia Statute was meant to protect everyone. And this is one of his famous quotes, including the Jew, the Gentile, the Christian, the Muslim, the Hindu, and the infidel of every denomination. he knew there are a lot of infidels out there. Jefferson and his contemporaries also saw religious freedom as the key to disentangling ancient, mutually reinforcing relationships between the economic and political interests of aristocrats and the institutional imperatives of the church. Jefferson called it an unholy alliance of kings, nobles, and priests that divided people in order to rule them. And he later wrote that his Virginia Statute was intended to put down the aristocracy of the clergy, to restore to the citizens the freedom of the mind. So Jefferson was very aware of the significance of his Virginia Statute. Historians, as well as Supreme Court justices since, widely regarded as the root of how the framers of the Constitution and later the First Amendment approached matters of religion and government. That's one reason why it's worth a quick look back at the powerful entrenched interests of his time. Interests who actively suppressed religious deviance and dissent. In Virginia, attendance was required at the Sunday services of the Church of England, rain or shine, and failure to attend was the most prosecuted crime for many years. Members of these Anglican church vestries were empowered to report religious crimes like heresy and blasphemy to local grand juries. Unsurprisingly, the wealthy planters and business owners who comprised the Anglican vestries were able to limit the access to this pipeline to political power. Dissenters from their theocratic dictates were dealt with harshly. In the years before the Revolution, Baptists, and other religious minorities in Virginia were victims of vigilante violence. Historian John Ragosta writes, "Men on horseback would often ride through crowds gathered to witness a baptism. Preachers were horsewhipped and dunked in rivers and ponds in a rude parody of their baptism ritual. Black attendees at meetings, whether free or slave, were subject to particularly savage beatings. Now, this was the social and political context in which Jefferson drafted the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom in 1777. But despite the revolutionary moment, it took a decade for the bill to be enacted, which finally happened under the leadership of James Madison in 1786. Following year, Madison traveled to Philadelphia, where he and his colleagues produced the Constitution. This document made no mention of God or Christianity or religion, except in one place, and that was in Article 6, which states that there shall be no religious test for public office anywhere in the United States. This single mention of religion was primarily in response to 150 years of colonial theocracies that preceded it, during which officials usually had to swear an oath of office based on the prevailing doctrine of the day. Now, the framers of the Constitution were wise to this, knowing that established churches in each state would not be compatible with democracy and religious freedom, but they also knew something that was at least as important, and that's, well, politicians lie. Just because people were willing to swear an oath didn't necessarily mean that they meant what they said. So Jefferson and others felt that the Constitution's silence on a number of matters, including freedom of religion, was insufficient, and agreed to support ratification only if it could be amended with a Bill of Rights later. And so it came to pass that Madison led the way in the first Congress, crafting the First Amendment, which we know provides for freedom of religion, freedom of speech, and freedom of the press. But in our siloized age, we usually see these things as separate matters. But in fact, there's a reason why they were all in one place, and perhaps even why they appear in that order. Without the right to think freely, believe as you will, there can't be any freedom of speech. And if you can't think freely, there can't be any freedom of the press either. Having said this, it's also clear that the struggle for religious freedom is far from over. And that's, you know, goes back to my thoughts about Washington. It's like, we all took this for granted. We thought it was a given, but it's far from over. The people who didn't like the Constitution when it's written, their descendants don't like it now. And so I think we face today, well, a lot of what we face today is a result of this, our taking religious freedom for granted, but also some very savvy exploitation of our unwariness by the theocratic strategies of today's Christian right. So, as you know, as it happens, I've spent much of my life studying various elements of the Christian right, and one lesson has stood out for me. And it's something that an influential theocratic theorist named Gary North calls the dilemma of democratic pluralism. And by this he means those of us who embrace democratic pluralism have to, as a matter of philosophical principle, tolerate those who do not share our values and in fact are dedicated to their destruction. But, you know, because of our unwariness and because of the smart effort to exploit it by the Christian right, a lot of people have engaged in wishful thinking. And so how many times have we heard variations of the story that the Christian right is dead or dying or greatly diminished? To read the news, you can Google the subject of the Christian right in any given week, and you'll find stories both that the religious right's doing great and that it's dead. Who knew? But what do you know? Now they are making national policy in close collaboration with the White House. But too many of our political, religious, and religious leaders, and certainly the media, have turned a blind eye to their growing political strength and poo-pooed their unambiguous theocratic vision. Gary North said, for example, that it may be worthwhile to temporarily advocate pluralism while plotting for the takeover. And I think that this is about where much of the movement is now. But we shouldn't be gulled by this. North flatly predicted, quote, pluralism will be shot to pieces in an ideological and perhaps even literal crossfire, as Christians and humanists sharpen and harden their positions in an escalating religious war. Now, the result of this protracted war would be religious and political dominion, of course, but North wrote this in the late 1980s, not all that long after I arrived in Washington. An all-out religious war has not yet broken out. It's also true that he regards as humanists, just about everyone who's, including Christians, who don't happen to subscribe to their particular version of Calvinist Protestantism. North and his colleagues know that they're a minority, seeking to leverage a wider coalition in order to ultimately take power. Now, once again, Gary North may seem like an obscure figure. Probably very few people have ever even heard of him, but he's far from alone. I could quote you contemporary Christian right political theorists and leaders who hold very similar views. They're patient theocrats and know that their vision will take time to implement. But we don't have to look very far to see elements of this movement operating in plain sight, like at the Trump Hotel this weekend in Washington. This turning a blind eye to political reality, though, has worked to the advantage of the Christian right because they know that our tolerance and our wishful thinking can sometimes be exploited. And because they know we live the dilemma of democratic pluralism every day. And so they know that it can be challenging for us to recognize the threats to our values, even exhausting, and this causes us great cognitive dissonance. So as a society, we've been very creative in finding ways not to see it. Sometimes people dismiss them as crazy extremists who cannot be taken seriously. It's a variation on the idea that it can't happen here. But in fact, it is happening here, and it's been happening for a long time, certainly all of my adult life. So let's also not turn a blind eye, however, to the idea of blind eye to what religious freedom has made possible for us. It was religious freedom that allowed Quakers, Evangelicals, and Unitarians to lead the way in opposing slavery in the 19th century. Religious freedom also allowed Catholics and mainline Protestants to guide society in creating child labor laws in the early 20th century. And later made it possible for religious groups and leaders to help to forge wide and evolving coalitions to advance African American civil rights and women's equality, to oppose the Vietnam War, and eventually to fight for LGBTQ civil and religious rights. Thus, the principle of equality under the law was a profoundly progressive and authentically revolutionary stance against the advantages enjoyed and enforced by ruling political and economic elites in the 18th century and ever since. One more quick note from the 18th century. In Virginia, marriages had to be consecrated by an Anglican priest, making dissenters marry within the Church of England, or to pay off the priest to get his cooperation in order to avoid, in order to obtain a legal marriage. The religious freedom then that Jefferson Madison sought was a freedom from corrupt and totalitarian religious control such as this. Such abuses may seem like a relic of the past, but in recent years, some conservative Christians have tried to outlaw the religious marriages of others. In 2012, Christian right advocates in North Carolina sought to build on existing laws limiting marriages to heterosexual couples by amending the state constitution, using language that would effectively criminalize the performance of marriage ceremonies without a license. This meant that clergy from a wide variety of religious traditions, from Judaism to Christianity to Buddhism, would be breaking the law as they solemnized religious marriage ceremonies for same-sex couples. And the motive was explicitly religious. One state senator citing the Bible and explaining his view said, "We need to regulate marriage because I believe that marriage is between a man and a woman." Now, this issue was part of a federal court case in 2014, General Synod of the United Church of Christ versus Resinger, in which a federal judge declared that laws that deny same-sex couples the right to marry were certainly unconstitutional, but specifically addressing this question of the criminalization of other people's religious marriages. He said it's unconstitutional to threaten clergy or other officiants who solemnize the union of same-sex couples with civil or criminal penalties. It was an historic victory, not just for marriage equality, but for a progressive vision of religious liberty. It's a piece that's often left out of these discussions. So even as we contend with all this, it's important not to lose sight of how the same idea that Jefferson and Madison codified into law in colonial Virginia has also become an international human rights standard. Article 18 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, passed by the General Assembly of the United Nations in 1948, states, "Everyone has the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right includes the freedom to change his religion or belief in freedom, either alone or in community, in public or in private, to manifest his religion or belief in teaching, practice, worship, and observance." Article 18 has been updated and gone into greater detail several times since then, but the basic principle remains the same. Still, the principle entered our culture only in fits and starts. And it's fair to say we're still working on it. Freedom of religion in the 18th century certainly did not mean freedom for all and in all respects, as African and Native American slaves, women, and people who were not landowners could attest. Nor did the principle eliminate religious prejudice and discrimination. It's just a principle. But what it did do, I think this is the important thing for us to remember, was that it facilitated every struggle for advances in human and civil rights ever since. And we've come a very long way, even though we have a long way to go. The struggle's gone global, and it's progressing. even as it's being met with familiar resistance. So it's in this sense that religious freedom is a progressive value. It makes possible freedom and equality for all. Kings, theocrats, and authoritarians of all sorts fear it, and rightfully so. Religious freedom is the cornerstone of democracy, and arguably the glue that holds us all together. So whatever our differences, we're unified in having the freedom to differ. So again, it's in that sense it's a progressive value, but it's also a conservative value. It's a mainstream value and a universal value. And it's our obligation and our opportunity to live it out, never losing sight of the dilemma of democratic pluralism and that the theocrats of our time seek to exploit and to carry it forward through the 21st century. Thank you for your kind attention. I don't recall him specifically saying that, but it's consistent with things he's said in the past about how he's a Christian first and a Republican second. So he absolutely uses his religious beliefs to frame his politics, and I think that he certainly fits my definition of a dominionist and does not share a more common sense view of religious freedom.
I'd just like to say that Reagan isn't very for bringing the religious right into politics. My understanding is that Carter did that long before Reagan became president. Unfortunately, that's the bulk of the Democratic Party. Also, you get the impression that Carter actually believed that stuff. I don't think Reagan ever actually personally adhered to any of it. Carter, I think, was really Reagan's mind.
Carter was an authentic Christian, and Reagan was not. He was a fraud. However, that said, it is also true that the Christian right and conservative elements sought to get Ronald Reagan the presidential nomination in 1976 over Gerald Ford and lost at the Republican convention by only one vote. They decided that rather than supporting Gerald Ford over Jimmy Carter in the general election in 76, that they would actually support Carter. Because, as you say, They wanted to mobilize evangelicals who saw Carter as one of them. Evangelicals had mostly been on the political sidelines since at least the Scopes trials, thinking they didn't want to risk their eternal soul by getting involved in the things of this world, which is run by Satan. Carter was a breakthrough and an opportunity for them. They would rather run against Jimmy, they would rather have Ronald Reagan run against Jimmy Carter in 1980 than to have to suffer through two terms of Gerald Ford. So it's not Jimmy Carter's fault, but Ronald Reagan, in fact, both Carter and Reagan got the benefit of the organizing of the Christian right. Glad to talk about it more later. Sorry, I missed
that. Yeah, you talked about the way the Supreme Court made it unconstitutional for anybody to threaten a minister for the way that they expressed their faith. Like, it's an expression of U.S. Pluralism, that last example you gave.
Well, what happened was the Supreme Court decided in the Obergefell decision that to honor marriage equality. And as a result, a federal court judge declared North Carolina laws banning marriage equality unconstitutional, but that federal judge also went an extra mile about what North Carolina was doing to specifically criminalize the performance of religious marriages that were not officially approved. I think the first thing is to recognize the problem that we're talking about, and that is that as a society, we're just not all on the same page about what kind of government we need to have and respect for each other's rights. And I think that we've been assuming too much about the good intentions of many of the people that were talking about the Christian right. When you hear them described as social conservatives, that's a dangerous euphemism. It does not describe the full thought of many of those folks. So in order for us to preserve a culture and a legal structure that respects democratic pluralism, we have to understand that the people who oppose us are a minority, and that we have to get very good at understanding and articulating what we mean by democratic pluralism and the kind of society that we want to have, but also to actively encourage a culture of participation. Because the Christian right has succeeded by exploiting our complacency. Our voter participation, our registration of those who are eligible is low compared to other industrialized countries. And our voter participation among those who are registered is also low. This is something that the Christian right has used to their advantage by being able to animate and train and mobilize their people in ways that are disproportionate to almost any other faction in society. So I see great hope in that. When people understand that that is the reality, it opens up the possibility for a more peaceful and democratic order. Part of it is, and part of it isn't. It's what you say is absolutely true for many, but there's also dynamic elements, particularly like the kind of people I'm talking about, the Trump Hotel, who come out of the Pentecostal tradition. And Pentecostal Christians have been historically very racially and ethnically inclusive, and they don't hold the same kind of black and white, if you will, viewpoint that many of their political co-belligerents do. They also often have women in leadership, and they have a very different kind of conservative Christian theocratic vision than some of the others. So it's important to see that this coalition is powerful because some of them are white patriarchs and some of them aren't, but they're still able to work together.
I don't sense in the country today, with the exception since 9/11, perhaps Islam, any threat to people worshiping or not worshiping in whatever faith they choose. There's no threat to atheists who choose not to worship at all. However, the threat I do see is where this or that religion tries to impose practices within that religion on the rest of the citizens. For example, on abortion, or a cake, or a gay marriage, or contraception, or whatever else they can find. That threat is real because the way it plays out, it goes to the Supreme Court. And we know that we cannot have faith. Whatever faith we have,
well, I agree. but I guess I rely on a quote from the more conservative philosopher of the Enlightenment, Edmund Burke, who said that the price of liberty is eternal vigilance. And that's what we're up against. I don't think that what we're up against is an insurmountable problem. As I said, I have great hope. I think we focus on the tremendous success and dangers of the present political order, including the Supreme Court. But, you know, this is why God gave us elections.